I want to read just one verse to get us started, verse 11 of chapter 13. John the Apostle said, I beheld another beast, and it was coming out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb, but he spoke like a dragon. In Jesus' Olivet Discourse, which covers Matthew's 24 and 25, he was answering the question, what shall be the sign of your coming? And at the end of the world, the word is aionios, or age in the Greek. What's the signs of your coming, and what's the end of the world or age? He said these words. He said, there shall be false Christ and false prophets, and they shall show signs and wonders. Jesus actually, in Matthew 24, verse 24, summarized the 13th chapter of the book of Revelation. False Christ, the first beast who comes out of the sea, verse 1, and false prophets, the second beast who comes off the land, in verse 11. So Revelation 13, we're introduced to two beasts. We saw the first beast, as I said, in verse 1. He is the beast who comes out of the sea, and we saw that that beast represents the Antichrist, this political man who will come on the scene, unify the world, when the world becomes one, once again, one world government. And then we see in Revelation chapter 11, a second beast, behold, another beast coming out of the earth. This second beast is none other than the false prophet. Now, there are a few different places, and we'll read them in just a moment, where the Bible actually calls this beast the false prophet. So we commonly call the first beast, in verse 1, the Antichrist, and he's a political leader. He unites the world as one. Then the second beast is known as the false prophet, and he's more of a religious leader, and he unites around the Antichrist with this one world religion in the last days before Christ returns. As Jesus predicted in Matthew 24, this beast will be the personification of satanic deception, Satan's final false prophet. Now, there are three things in this chapter about this false prophet that I want to point out if you're taking notes. The first is in verse 11 we just read. We see his person. He appears on the scene probably in the midpoint of the tribulation, and he's very prominent during the second half, but he joins with the Antichrist during the first half, but comes to his religious power in the second half, verse 1. John says, I beheld. So it's in the category of the visions that John had on the island of Patmos, and he uses the expression, another beast coming up out of the earth. He had two horns like a lamb, but he spoke like a dragon. Now, notice in verse 11, John used the phrase, another beast. Two things. Number one, the word another means another of the same kind. So the beast that comes off the land in verse 11 is of the same nature as the beast that came out of the sea in verse 1. But notice it also says the word beast there again. Same Greek word used in verse 11 for beast is the same word used in verse 1 for the beast. So they are closely related and, I believe, aligned with one another. The second beast is closely allied with the first beast, who is the Antichrist. They are a team. One is political and the other one is a religious leader. And we'll see that in just a moment. But they do differ. I want you to notice it in verse 11. The beast that comes out of the earth in verse 11 is different than the beast that comes out of the sea, two different places of their origin. So the first beast comes out of the sea, verse 1. The second beast comes out of the earth. Now, the word earth there, some Greek scholars point out, could be and perhaps should be translated land. And the inference there, and I don't know that we can really be dogmatic about it, is that this second beast will come out of the land of Israel and that possibly be Jewish in their ethnicity, that they'll be of Jewish origin. Now, we don't know. We can't be dogmatic. And again, we're reading about things that are future that happen after the rapture. So I don't think that we need to get bogged down in details that aren't really clear in the Scripture. It's funny that Christians like to leave the Bible and get into all this speculation about different people and who they are, where they're from, when the Bible doesn't say. So when the Bible doesn't speak, it's kind of best for us not to speak as well, but just take the word at what it says. So he, unlike the first beast, comes out of the earth or the land, and that's basically all it says. But then notice again in verse 11 that he had two horns. Now, the first beast in verse 1, he had seven heads, 10 horns, and upon his horns, 10 crowns, and upon his heads were the names of blasphemy. So there's a lot of graphic detail about the first beast in verse 1 that is different than the second beast in verse 2, or verse 11, excuse me. Verse 11 tells us that this religious beast actually has two horns. Now, the horns in biblical symbolism speaks of power or authority. And it's possible, again, we can't be dogmatic, that the first beast had 10 horns. He had more power politically because these 10 horns all had 10 crowns on them, which speak of political power. They're called diadems. So they were kingly crowns. But the second beast, he only has 2 horns, no crown. So you need to pay attention whenever you're looking at Bible prophecy to details, because many times people miss these points. So I believe that these 2 horns means that he has authority, but without the crowns, no doubt not political power or political authority. But this is what's significant in verse 11. He looked like a lamb. So he was like a lamb that had 2 horns. This indicates that he is a religious leader, that he has a false religion or false spirituality, that he is an ecumenical leader of all these different groups, bringing them together. Now, when we get to Revelation chapter 17, we're going to see a woman riding a beast, which is called Mystery Babylon, the mother of harlots. And I believe that that's the culmination of this religious leader's work in uniting the world under one banner, this ecumenical of one world religion, and it's riding the Antichrist during the second half of the tribulation, but God will destroy this religious system. So he is aligned with the Antichrist. He doesn't have political power. He looks like a lamb, so he has religious power. But then notice also, he spake like a what? Dragon. Grandma, what big teeth you have. You look like a lamb, but you speak like a dragon. So he is invested with power from Satan himself, and his words are false and deception. Jesus, again, in Matthew chapter 7, verse 15, which is the end of his famous Sermon on the Mount, he said, "Beware of false prophets which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly, they are ravening wolves." You ever have someone knock on your door and say, "Hi, we're from the Kingdom Hall. We're Jehovah's Witnesses. We're Christians. We believe in Jesus. We have a Bible. We quote Scripture." Bah, bah. Same vocabulary, different dictionary, trust me. Different Bible, not based on the Greek, and it's their own translation to promote their own false teachings. There are all kinds of, they'll come to you. Notice that Jesus said, they come to you. You don't go to them, they come to you. The cultists on your doorstep. You need to be biblically grounded and discerning as to the truth of God's word. So Jesus warned us, they will come looking like sheep, maybe smelling like sheep, talking like sheep, acting like sheep, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves. So this beast out of the land is actually the false prophet who comes speaking like a dragon, even though he looks like a lamb. We must be careful. So this beast of the earth is the false prophet. Now you say, well, Pastor John, it doesn't say false prophet. So turn with me, hold your place in Revelation 13, to Revelation 16 and verse 13. We're going to do a little bit of turning to other places to clarify our chapter 13. But notice in verse 13 of Revelation 16, John says, "I saw three unclean spirits like frogs come out of the mouth of the dragon, out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of, here it is, the false prophet. Now, it's interesting that Satan is an imitator, and so he tries to imitate the Trinity. We have the dragon, which is the anti-God the Father, false God the Father. We have the beast, which is the first beast of Revelation chapter 13, verse 1, the Antichrist, the imitation of God the Son. And then we have the false prophet, which is the second beast from Revelation 13, 11, who is actually the false prophet, which is the anti-Holy Spirit. So just as there's God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, there's the dragon, there's the Antichrist, and then there is the false prophet, who we're going to see does miracles and points people to worship the Antichrist. The work of the Holy Spirit is to point people to Jesus Christ. Amen? You can always tell if it's a genuine work of the Spirit of God because it's always pointing people to Jesus Christ. Whenever a messenger is pointing to themselves, it's not the work of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is always pointing to Jesus Christ. That's a good way to determine the truth of an individual and aligning it with his word. Now, notice this false prophet is called a beast. He comes out of the earth. And I believe that we are set today for the appearance of this false prophet. Go back with me to Revelation chapter 13, verse 11. In what ways do we see the stage being set today for this false prophet to come on the world? Well, the Bible says that in the last days, many shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits, and listen carefully, doctrines of demons. There are several places in the New Testament where we are warned that as the church, one of the signs of the end of time is apostasy in the church. Now, apostasy, which means the turning away, is classically and I think rightfully defined as people who were not truly saved, were not born again, were not regenerated, weren't real Christians, but they were name only Christians, and they come to the place where they don't believe in Christianity anymore, they don't believe the Bible is the Word of God anymore, they don't believe that Jesus is the only way anymore, they don't believe Jesus rose from the dead. They deny all of the doctrines of Orthodox Christianity, but they still call themselves Christians. We have seen in the last 50 years, at least in a radical way, many of the mainline denominations in America and many independent churches now as well turn away from the faith once and for all delivered to the saints. You better know what you believe and why you believe it, and it better be based on God's word. Amen. You need to be a Berean and search the scriptures to see whether these things are so. Don't just say, well, they got a big church, they're a good speaker, they're charismatic, aren't they wonderful? You need to align what they teach with the Word of God. This is why on Wednesday nights I'd encourage you to join us. We're going through the book of Galatians, which Paul wrote to defend the gospel of Jesus Christ against false teachers who are deluding and perverting the gospel of Christ. It's so prevalent today that it's almost hard to find a church that still holds to Orthodox Christianity, which starts, by the way, with a very high view of the book we call the Bible. Amen. That it is God's inspired, inerrant, infallible, sufficient word. I believe in the inerrancy of Scripture. There's no errors in the Bible. I believe in the sufficiency of Scripture, the inspiration of Scripture. And I believe it's the final authority for all faith and practice. The authority is not the church, the authority is not the Pope, the authority is not the preacher, the authority is not church tradition, not church history, not our intellects or our own experience or our own emotion. It's the Bible, the Word of God. Amen? Amen. And that's so very important. People don't pick churches today because of their doctrine. They pick them because they like it. It's appealing, it's exciting, it's great. And that's all wonderful, but they have to be doctrinally, biblically based, or we are sitting ducks for the false prophets, the wolves in sheep's clothing. We also see the rise today of what's called ecumenicalism. Big word, ecumenicalism. It started several years ago with what was called the World Council of Churches, where all these different groups get together and they all hold hands and they have a harmonic conversion and they all think that everything's cool and there's no absolute truth, that your truth is your truth, my truth is my truth, and that we can harmonize or we can bring together all religions and all faiths as one. And that's what we're seeing today and will culminate in the time of the tribulation. And then we also see the rise of what's called pluralism. And pluralism is basically that there's no absolute truth. And that one religion can't say that it's better than another religion, or that you have the truth and they don't have the truth, or that you're right and they're wrong. And especially when it comes to the very words of Jesus himself, where he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except how? By me. Now that's pretty clear, isn't it? I've quoted that verse to people and they go, that's just your interpretation. No, I'm just quoting it. I'm not interpreting anything. That's just what Jesus said, which means it's either true or it's false. We don't believe that those categories exist. Everybody's truth is true, which is self-contradictory. But they're so intolerant of the believer who takes a stand for the truth that's found in Jesus Christ. So we're being conditioned by the world today. Now, I hate to single her out, but Oprah Winfrey is one of the leaders in this pluralism, ecumenicalism, and false spirituality, demonically energized spirituality. Jesus can't be the only way to God, she says. All paths lead to God. And so many listen to her false teachings. So the world is being set for this false prophet to come on the stage. Now I want to note, secondly, his power. And we see the background for it in verses 12 to 15. Follow with me in your Bible. He is a person. Notice in verse 11 that twice the personal pronoun he is used. And then again in verse 12, actually from verse 11 down to verse 16, nine times it's either he or him. He is a person. He's a personification of satanic deception. So he exercises all the power of the first beast, the Antichrist, before him. He causes the earth and them that dwell therein to worship the first beast, that's back in verse 1, whose deadly wound was healed, and he does great wonders, the word is signs, and he makes the fire to come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men. He deceives them that dwell upon the earth, verse 14, by means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image of the beast, which had the wound by the sword and did live. And he had power to give life, verse 15, unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause as many as would not worship the image of the beast, the Antichrist, should be killed or put to death. Now, I want you to note five facts about this false prophet's power. Number one, he is delegated authority or power from the Antichrist, who is given his power and authority from Satan himself, the great red dragon. So he is delegated authority and power. He's aligned with the Antichrist. Secondly, notice that he causes the whole world, verse 12, to worship the beast who is the Antichrist. Now, as I just mentioned, the Holy Spirit's job is to get people to worship Jesus Christ. So the false prophet's job, the anti-Holy Spirit, is to get people to worship the Antichrist, Satan's deception and imitation. And then thirdly, he performs powerful signs and wonders. Look at verse 13. He does great wonders or signs so that he makes fire to come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men. Now, it's interesting that God many times would give his true prophets the ability to perform signs, and that sign title means they point to something. But not only do you have to have the miraculous, you have to have the message. The message has to be from God, not of men's own origin. So Elijah came and he called fire down from heaven. Perhaps he's one of the two witnesses and it's going on at this time. Remember, one of the witnesses, or the witnesses have power to actually breathe fire and consume those who oppose them during this time. So this guy wants to imitate not only Elijah, but the two witnesses, and he calls fire to come down from heaven. Now, it's interesting, in the book of Job, when Satan attacked Job and he took out all of his animals and his livestock, guess how Satan did that? Fire came down from heaven and devoured them or consumed them. So it seems to be one of Satan's tricks. And here's the point. Satan has the power to perform supernatural miracles. So be careful you're not deceived. Satan has the power to imitate and perform supernatural miracles. You say, well, what's my defense? How can I protect myself? The Bible, the Word of God. It's the lamp to our feet and the light to our path. So your authority isn't that I saw it, I felt it, I heard it, I experienced it. Your authority is the Bible, the Word of God, and all experience must be submitted to the authority of Scripture. But Satan certainly has power. Remember when Moses went into the court of Pharaoh and he threw his rod on the ground and the rod became what? A snake. Wow, power of God. But the Pharaoh says, no big deal, cheap magician's trick. He called his magicians in. They threw their rods, two of their magicians threw their rods down, and their rods became snakes too. And Moses might have been, oh, wow, that's, what am I going to do? And then his snake ate up their snake. Amen? God's power is greater. I love it. And the two magicians went, man, I spent a lot of money at the magic shop buying those things. Just lost my magic rod. But my message to you is be careful. I don't believe that as Christians we should be following or chasing or running after signs and wonders. Amen. I believe signs and wonders should follow believers, but we shouldn't be following them. Amen? We need to be grounded in God's Word, which is true and objective truth. So, the safeguard for us is God's Word. But notice third fact in verse 14, he deceives unseen earth dwellers. Now I emphasize earth dwellers because that's what we have in the text where we realize that these are unbelievers, unsaved people. Verse 14, he deceiveth them that dwell on the earth. How? By means of the miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast. So these people are deceived by his supernatural power. They don't have the truth of God's Word. They don't love the Word of God. And they're not believers. They don't have the Holy Spirit to give them spiritual discernment. It's interesting, the word deceiveth in verse 14 is where we get our word from, the Greek word translated deceiveth. We get our word planet. And it has the idea of to wander or to lead astray, because we notice the planets were moving, so it means to move away or to be left astray. Write down 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verses 9 and 10, and I'll read it to you in the New Living Translation. Paul says, this man will come to do the work of Satan with counterfeit power. Now, in the context, I believe he's referring to Antichrist. But the Antichrist gives the false prophet his power and his authority as well. He works in alignment with him. But so they come, both of them, with counterfeit power, signs, and miracles. They will use every kind of evil deception to fool those on their way to destruction because they refuse to love and accept the truth that should save them. So they have rejected the truth of God and to love God's Word, and they have been led astray. But notice fact number 5 in verse 14 and 15, he commits, I believe, the abomination of desolation, which was prophesied in the book of Daniel, chapter 9, verse 27. Follow with me, midpoint of verse 14. It says there that he says to them that dwell on the earth, verse 14, that they should make an image of the beast, who is the Antichrist, which had the wound by the sword and did live. And he even had power, verse 15, to give life. The word is pneuma, which really means breath. Questionable whether he would give the image life, but he gave it the appearance of breathing to the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause as many as would not worship that image of the beast should be killed or put to death. Now, I believe we have the background in these verses, end of verse 14 and verse 15. You might want to make a note for what was prophesied in the book of Daniel as the abomination of desolation. This is when the Antichrist has an erected image of himself in a rebuilt temple in Jerusalem, and the false prophet actually is instrumental in getting that image erected, and he commands the whole world to worship this image. Then he gives the image the appearance of having life or breathing and being able to be an animate object and being able to communicate. And the whole world comes and wonders and worships after the beast and worships this idol, the statue that is erected in the temple of the Jews, rebuilt on the Temple Mount, which is the desecration or the abomination of that holy place. Jesus mentioned it in Matthew 24 and verse 15 as one of the signs that will take place just before his second coming. So it's yet future. It happens in the middle of the tribulation. There are three and a half years left until Christ returns. Jesus said, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, he said, then flee into the mountains. And he said, be careful that you don't go down to take your belongings, that you flee for your lives. And then it's mentioned in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 4. Now, let me give you those verses if you're taking notes so you can look them up. Daniel 9, 27, Matthew 24, verse 15, and 2 Thessalonians 2 and verse 4. Those are classic passages on the abomination of desolation. Now, in 2 Thessalonians 2, 4, Paul says, he opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshiped, so that he as God sits in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. So there Paul explains that this is what is the abomination of desolation. He sets up an image of himself, declares himself to be God, and they command the whole world to bow down and to begin to worship him. And if you don't worship him, then you are put to death or you are killed. Now, I don't want to take much time, but there's an interesting story in the book of Daniel, chapter 3, about King Nebuchadnezzar who erects this giant statue of pure gold. Now, in chapter 2, if you back up one chapter of Daniel, he had a dream of a big statue that had just a head of gold, had breast and arms of silver, had a belly and thighs of brass, had legs of iron, and feet and toes mingled with iron and clay. And that image, it represented Babylon, Medo-Persian, Greece, and Rome. And then the revived Roman Empire, the feet and toes of iron and clay, when a rock cut without hands from the heavens struck the image, and it all crumbled, and the rock then grew into a massive mountain and went on forever. That's a reference to the second coming of Jesus Christ, crumbling or destroying the kingdoms of man and setting up his kingdom, which will be an everlasting kingdom. So King Nebuchadnezzar, back to chapter 3, says, no, 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 no. I'm paraphrasing. I'm not just the head of gold. I'm all gold. And my kingdom will continue. It won't come to an end. So in defiance to the God of heaven, he builds this huge statue, all of gold, and commands everyone to do what? Bow down and worship this image. Guess how tall the image was? 60 cubits and 6 cubits wide. Huge statue out in the plains of Dura. And so he says, okay, when the band starts up, everyone bow, everyone worship this image of me. So the band started, everyone bowed, but three young Hebrew boys, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Don't you love these guys? Everyone's on their face, bowed down, and they're standing like this. Ooh. You sure we're doing the right thing here, boys? This is scary. Hang on. Here we go. And everybody's bowing around them, and they're standing tall. And the king sees them and says, call them to me. And he calls these three Hebrews, and he says, what are you doing? They said, well, king, we just need to inform you that we're not going to bow down. We're not going to worship your golden image. And if you do throw us in the fiery furnace, our God is able to deliver us. So the king gets really, he's hotter than his furnace. And he heats it up seven times, which is an interesting biblical number, seven times, 7 years of tribulation. And he says, one more chance. And the band started out, one and a two and a three. And they started up the music. Everyone hits their face on the earth and they're standing tall. They wouldn't bow, they wouldn't bend, and they wouldn't burn, right? So the king says, have them thrown into the furnace. And the furnace is so hot that the men who threw them in were burnt to death. And they landed bound with their hands and feet into this fiery furnace. And nothing burned but the ropes. Can you dig that? And the ropes popped off, and they're walking around having a hallelujah time in the fire. King walks up and goes, ooh, hey, how many guys did we throw in there? They go, three. He goes, I see four. And the image of the fourth looks like the Son of God. I believe that's what's called a Christophany, where Christ in his pre-incarnate glory left heaven, came to earth to hang out with the three Hebrews in the fiery furnace. You know, when you're going through the fire and you're going through the trials and you're going through difficulties, guess who's with you? Jesus. And so the king actually had to ask them, come out. Now, if I fell bound into a furnace with ropes and they burnt, I would go out immediately. Whoa, I'm out of here. But the king says, hey, come on out. And he come on out, and they didn't even smell like smoke. King had to acknowledge there is a God in heaven, amen, who has greater power than anything. So don't ever be afraid of Satan's power, Satan's devices. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Now, thirdly and lastly, let's look at his program in verse 16 to 18. So we saw his person, verse 11. We see his power, verse 12 to 15. But notice, thirdly, his program. What's his purpose and plan? He causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, bond and free. That's just about every human being on planet Earth. The Earth becomes one. To receive a mark on their right hand or on their forehead. Very specific where on the body he's going to mark these individuals. That no man might buy or sell save he that has the mark. So if you don't have this mark, you can't buy anything, you can't sell anything, you can't go anywhere. You're stuck. Save he that had the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. And here is wisdom, verse 18. Let him that hath understanding count the number of the beast. And notice this catchphrase, for it is the number of a man. Six is the number of man. And his number is 666, or you know it, 666, right? This is what is commonly known as the mark of the beast. So the false prophet, not content to deceive people by miracles, idolatrous worship, now commands everyone to receive a mark to control the world economy. Remember, he's allied with the Antichrist, the political leader, and the world has become one. There's a revived Roman Empire, and he's actually conquered the world. And he's been given Satan's power and authority and seat. So now he has his religious sidekick, his right-hand man, the false prophet, that gets all of the religious world through spiritual deception to align with him. And now they are commanded to worship the image of the Antichrist, the beast, which I believe is, I said, erected in the rebuilt temple in Jerusalem. It's the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet. Jesus warned us of it. And they're commanded to worship this image or take his mark and take his mark or be put to death. Now, if you turn with me real quickly to Revelation 14, and we'll wrap this up come back to Revelation chapter 13. Turn just one chapter, chapter 14, verse 9 to 11. What would happen, what will happen to those who take the mark of the beast? Here's where we find out. Revelation 14, 9. Third angel followed. Now there's the first angel in verse 6 and 7 of Revelation 14, preaching the everlasting gospel. There's the second angel in verse 8, preaching Babylon has fallen. And then a third angel says, follows, saying with a loud voice, verse 9, if any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in their forehead or in his hand, here it is, verse 10, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the Lord, of the holy angels, and of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment ascended up forever, verse 11, and ever. And he had no rest day nor night, who worshiped the beast and his image, and whosoever receives his mark or his of his name. So this is telling us, and we'll get there in a couple of weeks in Revelation 14, what will happen to those who take the mark of the beast and worship his image. Now, go back with me to chapter 13, and we close in verse 18. Herein is wisdom. Let him that understanding has understanding count the number of the beast. It is the number of man. I believe that that's the statement that we need to hang on to. His number is 666. 666. Now, a lot of confusion, a lot of craziness, a lot of bizarre speculation comes around the mark of the beast. What is the mark of the beast? When will the mark of the beast come? All kinds of questions. I don't have time to deal with them. But let me say this. I believe that this mark of the beast will be instituted by the false prophet, by the Antichrist, and it will be instituted in the second half of the tribulation. You go, okay, that's fine. But I do believe that the church, the true believers, the body of Christ, the bride of Christ, will be raptured, caught up to meet Christ in the air, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, before the Antichrist, the first beast, shows up, before the false prophet shows up, and before the abomination of desolation, and before the mark of the beast. So if the church has not been raptured, we do not have the mark of the beast. And I say that because there are some people freaking out, believing that the COVID-19 vaccination is the mark of the beast. Well, if that happened, then we weren't raptured. We're in the tribulation. There should be the Antichrist. There should be angels flying around saying, don't take the mark. If you do, you're doomed. It's not happening. So I don't believe the vaccination, the vaccine, COVID vaccine, is the mark of the beast. Now, whether you take it or not, that's up to you. I'm not telling you should or you shouldn't, but you're not taking the mark of the beast, okay? It's okay. Now, a lot of people try to figure out by the number, 666. Let's see. Let's figure that out. Let's add it up. In the Greek and in the Hebrew, as in other ancient languages, letters had numeric value. All their alphabet had numeric value. So you could take a name and you could use the name to add up the numbers in the name and see if it adds up to 666. So what has happened is people have gotten so wrapped up in this that they've concluded that, you know, Hitler was the Antichrist, Caesar was the Antichrist, all the popes have been the Antichrist. You can take about any name you want, and if you massage it enough and work it enough, you can come up with 666. And again, I think it's futile, and it's foolish, and it's a waste of time. I don't know who the Antichrist will be, but I don't plan on being around to meet the dude, okay? I plan on being caught up to meet the real Jesus Christ the Messiah, the Savior of the world. Amen? That's who I'm looking for. So yes, we see the stage set. Apostasy, ecumenicalism, pluralism. Yes, we see the stage set, spiritism. And it's been kind of a freaky thing this past year with the COVID. You can't come in unless you have a mask. Maybe it's going to go to the point where you can't come in unless you've been vaccinated. You can't come in unless you have your special ID card. It's pretty freaky to go into a place of business and have them take your temperature. But this is not the tribulation. We haven't missed the rapture. Jesus Christ is coming back for the church. That's the blessed hope that we need to hang on to. And try as hard as you will, 666, and you're not going to figure out who the Antichrist is, okay? But it is interesting that 6 in biblical numerology is the number of man. And the statement says in verse 18 that it is the number of a man. Man was created on the 6th day. Number 7 is the day of perfection or completion. So he is far short of being the true Messiah, the Savior of the world. Now, you say, well, how is the false prophet and how will the Antichrist come to an end? I'm glad you asked. And believe me, this is my last verse. But in closing, turn to Revelation 19, verse 20. Revelation 19, 20. This is right at the second coming when Jesus Christ returns. And what does he do to the beast and the false prophet? Notice verse 20, 19:20. The beast was taken, and with him the false prophet that wrought the miracles before him, which had deceived them that received the mark of the beast and them which worshipped his image. These both, that is the Antichrist and the false prophet, were cast alive into a lake burning with fire and brimstone. Amen? Jesus Christ will come again, and he will put to an end the Antichrist, the beast from the sea, and the false prophet, the beast from the earth, and he will set up his kingdom, which is an everlasting kingdom. And the dragon, Satan, will be bound for 1,000 years as Christ reigns on earth in righteousness. Let's pray.